Donald Mack now will bring us a reading, Joy to the World in Double Measure.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Okay, Joy to the World in Double Measure by Marian Monroe. Joy to the World is one of the best-known and most-loved English-language Christmas carols, but there's more to it than most people realize. The first verse captures the overwhelming joy and excitement at the birth of the Messiah, Jesus, 2,000 years ago. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and heaven and nature sing. But now take a look, close look at the second verse. Joy to the earth, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ. The Jesus that was born in Bethlehem manger didn't reign over all the earth or even part of it. To the contrary, he was rejected, betrayed, ridiculed, and crucified. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. All the prophecies of the Bible about the Messiah ruling the world in love, he shall judge the world with his righteousness and the people with his truth. Four examples refer to Jesus' second coming. While fields and rocks, hills and plains repeat the sounding joy, these lines echo another Old Testament prophecy about the Messiah. For you shall go out with joy and be led with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth into singing before you, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Now in verse 3, no more let sin and sorrow grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He's come to make his blessings flow as far as the curse is found. That prophecy about the mountains and the trees and rejoicing goes on to say, instead of thorns shall come up cypress trees, and instead of briars shall come up the myrtle tree, and it shall be to the Lord for a name and for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. Thorns and thistles were part of the curse God put on the earth after the fall of man, and they continue to this day. So clearly, these lines are also about Jesus' return. Another prophecy, one from the final chapter of the New Testament, which is about heaven, says, and there shall no more curse of sin, there shall be no more curse of sin, but the throne of God and of the Lamb Jesus shall be in the heavenly city, New Jerusalem, and his servants shall serve him.
Amen.
In verse 4, he rules the world with truth and grace and makes the nations prove the glory of his righteousness and the wonders of his love. And the wonders of his love, and the wonders, wonders. Although his blessings are plentiful and wonderful now, when he comes back to live among us as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, we'll experience his blessings in an even more tangible way. Now he lives in us, but then he will live among us for all the nations to see and everyone to know. No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord, and as the waters cover the sea. The God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. You, Jesus, shall judge the people righteously and govern the nations on the earth. When Jesus came the first time, he showed us what God was like, taught us how to live, and paid for our salvation with his own blood. That certainly gives us reason to rejoice. But but we can be joyful in double measure in advance for his promised return, when he will lift the curse, restore peace and harmony to the world, and rule in love. He did not bring joy to the world once, but keeps giving and giving and giving, now and forever.
Amen.
All right. Now in your bulletins and everything, there was a little thing here, a little paper, says, sing joy.